Okay. Brilliant view of the lights. As we get ready to start, 2002 Australian Grand Prix. Slight slow start there. By slightly slow, I mean we get jumped. Lose two positions on the start. That's about our average, so we won't complain too much. Still means we're in fourth. Still gives us hope. All's not lost. Long race and all that. All will be lost if I keep locking up those tires, though. Something to watch out for. Tire wear not that big an issue, considering I've turned it off, because that's how you race against the AI in this game. So yeah. Trying here to survive the first few chaotic laps of the Grand Prix. Try to hold on to our front position as much as we can. No point in just pulling off a very good qualifying by my standards, where, because I usually throw it away in qualifying. No point squandering that in the first few laps. I want to at least hold on to it for the first stint of this race. And then it'll all go to shit in the last 5 laps. That's a story for about 50 laps time. Oh! Orange got very sideways there. That seems to be a thing the AI does here at Melbourne, is that second last corner. Well, third last, really. Anyway, they catch the curb there and they like to go sideways. I've yet to see one actually spin out. Yet they seem to be very good at catching those slides. Yeah, so we could be expecting to pass the arrow car up ahead with that. So yeah. Seem to be putting a small bit of a gap onto the cars behind. As I can see, this front group just getting away with each other. They seem to be quite evenly paced up here at the front. And we're just dropping the group behind. We're possibly fighting amongst themselves, which is going to hold them up. Now let's try to get settled into a rhythm here. Into this 58 lap Australian Grand Prix. So yeah, why am I doing a full-length Grand Prix out of nowhere? Well, it's not exactly out of nowhere. I'm planning to do as many of these races as I can for the 2002 season on their 15th anniversaries. I know 15 years is not exactly a very significant anniversary, but it was the only one I could find based on Automobile. So, you know, all the other mods and series are off by a few years to anything significant, you know. 19 years since the 98 kart season? Yeah, that doesn't really attract you as much as 15 years since 2002 F1 season. Sounds a bit sexier, you know. So yeah, 15 years since this was what F1 looked like. Things have changed a bit, haven't they? Well, sound different. We have actual slick tires now. Quality is questionable, but. And what's interesting, as the leader loses it, I believe that's Siano Trulli, he should be. What's also interesting about this year F1 is this is what 2017 rules are trying to get back to. Back to the wide looking cars with the low wings and they look fast, they look menacing. This is what I'm trying to do. Trying to get a sort of a hybrid between the mid-90s F1 cars and sort of these. And they lock up the tires. That's a good thing to do. Left front overheat, that's nice. But yeah, interesting that 15 years ago this is what F1 looked like, and sort of 2017 F1 cars are going to sort of look like Well, it finally looked like the cars that we thought future F1 was going to look like. Yeah, you see all these F1 concept cars with the mad wings, and generally they look fast. And 2017 promises to be that finally. Well, I doubt that's going to be that. You know? We just have to move on and live with that. Now, thanks to those mistakes, the Renault should be Jenson Button. Behind has caught up again. I think they've broken away slightly from the pack behind. This race is not splitting up that much. We'll try to get back onto the group in front. Yep, that was my logic for doing this. Is the only F1 mod I could get for Automobilista that had some sort of semi-significant anniversary. Maybe if I looked hard enough I could find something. But we're not going to push ourselves over that. Also, I may just want to use these Formula V10 cars because I quite like them. Probably because they're, of all the Formula 1 cars in Automobilista, I think they're the easiest to drive. It should make sense because these are from an era where regulations were allowing more downforce to get out to the cars and not aiming to take it away, which is what they did. I don't know, about 5 years after this? 2009, 2002, that math does not add up, but yeah, in 2009 they stripped away the downforce and that was that. Despite these being amongst the most powerful F1 cars in Automobilista, I believe they're beaten by the Formula Classics, which are the late 80s turbo cars, and possibly the 2014 car. And despite having grooved tires, they still have plenty of grip for their power. It is pretty well balanced, actually. So driving wise, they're pretty easy to drive. I know that's the exact opposite of real life. The main challenge in real life was just physically handling these things because of how fast they were. And that was definitely something to adjust to. When I began to get into this, start practicing, because, well, obviously, if you want to attempt to do a full Grand Prix, you probably should practice a little bit. And one of the things to get over was how bloody fast these things are. Yeah. I spend most of my sim racing time in sports cars. GT cars, mainly at that. And then when you go into F1 cars, especially any relatively modern F1 car, say 1990 forwards, even afterwards. Hell, even from the 80s onwards, right? These cars are stupidly fast, just in pure speed. You know, you're out of the corner, and now you're into a corner. And you just gotta get used to that. Also get used to the infinite grip. So this arrow's car up ahead is beginning to hold us up. I wonder who's ahead of me. Is that Jack Greenlove or is it Penny? Yeah, it's Olivia Penny.
Watch your right. All clear.
That was a dive and a half. I don't know how much I saw because the game decided to freeze up there. It's a problem I'm running into with Automobilista, the current version, when I'm running AI races, is when you get close to AI, the game seems to like freeze up because as it tries to panic and think, oh, what should I be doing? There's people near the cars. What am I going to do? Are we going to race? What's happening? And it really hurts in moments like that where I need to do about 20 things in the space of half a second to avoid catastrophe. And the game has to do that as well, and that's why it's panicking. So no one wins out of that. Well, anyway, after that mad dive, we are now up into the turret, which is a good running. Not sure if the Jordans this season actually got a podium. I don't think they did. I think this is slightly, 2002 is slightly after Jordan's sort of peak of competitiveness in Formula 1. I would be able to tell you if I wasn't like three when this season actually happened. Whoa.
On your left. Keep right. Watch your left.
What the heck?
The caution flag is out.
Oh, what a cunt.
Right side.
Let's go through here. Well then.
Watch your right. Watch your right.
This race got interesting.
Clear right.
We have some revenge to dish out. What the hell? What a guy. Well, that there explains why arrows never did anything in their life. Well, that would be a drive through if that was a thing in this game for contact. I don't believe you can get. Well, maybe. But I don't think AI can get penalties for their own conduct. Damn, again, too into this Formula 1 shit. It began to call out penalties and crap. I'm pretty annoyed with that. Not going to lie. Bloody good thing this is a long race. The unfortunate thing is, compared to actual F1, is that this field is competitive. You know, it's just how Automobilista works. This is mod reason, as it should probably get to pretty soon, is just a collection of all the 2002 skin mods I could find. Like, it's not an actual mod pack. I individually got all these skins, compiled them together, made them work together and all happy. Which means that none of the positions are realistic. Like, we have Ralf Schumacher here hanging out at the back of the field. That's not really realistic. You know, the fact that this Jordan we're in could have, you know, qualified in second, that's not realistic against this field. So, essentially, we're all in the same cars, and the AI is randomly deciding amongst itself who's going to be quick this week, so. The results in quite a competitive field, which is fun to race, if not very realistic, for how F1 was in this day and age. You know, in general, this just races like a spec series. Very good spec series at that. Alright, so that was a disaster. Because now we're behind the pack that was chasing us, which is huge, looking by it. Looking at it, I can learn to speak. Of course, missing your shift there doesn't help, as we are trying to get a move on. This Hesse is a name, though. We need to try to get ourselves back onto the podium. When we find that other Arrows driver who punches us off, maybe don't be so nice with him as well. We'll settle this our own way. Probably could have been a little bit more clever there in dealing with that.
Watch your left. Clear left.
Need to be aggressive. So while that was a bit borderline, we don't have time to waste. Yeah, the tricky thing with this pack is going to be trying to pick people off individually. unfortunately, it looks like this Minardi is just about hanging on by a spare teat. Weber, actually. Weber in real life had a good run in this race. He scored his first point here. This was also his debut, so he's a rookie. We're in Takuma Sato's car. I don't think this was his rookie season, I don't... Could be. He's still a fairly young driver at this stage. I like how all the skid marks from locking up have been mine. It's like they are somewhat competent. Get back there, Ralph. You're having none of it. Taking a bit of a risk there, going out onto the AstroTurf. But it's not much faster, so I don't know why I do it. I should probably stop. Of course, this is illustrating why F1 was known for her possessions in this era. I'm fascinated these guys. I qualified ahead of them and was slowly pulling away from them. But the emphasis on is the slowly crash. That's the main point. And this is just how F1 is. You may gain time, but you can barely see it. It takes several laps to get anywhere in F1. Of course, when they make mistakes at that, it's much easier.
Keep right. Clear.
You're stubborn. Showing some grit. Now stop my please. This seems good in the front straight, actually. Maybe I should stop trying to overtaking like the second last corner and instead hold back and slipstream him on the front straight and overtaking the turn one. Sounds like a better plan. Nearly lost it there. Everything's fine. Nothing to see here. Everything's fine. Oh, dust getting thrown up. That's nice. It's one thing all Melissa doesn't have is visors getting dirty and windscreens getting dirty. There's a lot I don't like about iRacing, but that's one of the things I do quite like. I'm sure there's a way to get to work in the G-Motor 2 engine. Alright, so he won't overtake here, but we'll stay right on top of him. I'll go for an overtake in the first corner, if we get a good enough run. Come on, slipstream. I think we're slightly too far back. We can make a dive.
All clear.
And nearly get punished for it. I have no idea how we held that. That, kids, is why you don't dive bomb. Nice or good. Oh, Ralph is trying to give us a taste of our own medicine with a little bit of tapping for good measure. It's like an awful curve there, yet I keep going for the apex. I shouldn't. Because, you know, no one puts a curve perpendicular to the track. A curve perpendicular to the track, you know, for the hell of it. They're trying to unsettle the car and make you spin. It's definitely a thing you gotta watch out for Melbourne, and it's with the curbs. Some of the apex curves are like ridiculously spinny, as the cars around us are demonstrating in certain corners, where for some reason the AA line insists on touching the apex, and then the car spins. I was like, whoa, what do? I thought this was cool. here, Mark Webber gives us another demonstration of why you don't touch that curb. Though the fact that these cars are actually quite saleable for an F1 car, another reason why I like them. Like, if you're looking for a challenge, these are not your cars, but still fun. Yeah, it's definitely a good place to start, actually. For, you know, for trying to do full-length Grand Prix. In the grand scheme of things, the Grand Prix isn't actually that long a race. It's like 2 hours is the maximum it's allowed. Only 300 kilometers. It's not that long. People say, like, oh, F1 races drag on. Like, they're not. It's mainly because they're quite boring. That's why they feel like they're so long. You know, an F1 race can feel as long as a 6-hour WEC race. But the difference is there's more going on in the WEC race. Well, it was last year. Hopefully it survives. With much defeated LMP1 Plus and Spec LMP2 and hopefully GT is competitive. Alright, moving on. There seems to be some action up ahead. Cars are going side by side. There's actual racing in an F1 race. Madness, I tell you. And Webber seems to got screwed by that whole affair and got absolutely no run. He got held up badly by Schumacher. There's another demonstration of that these finishing positions, the results from these races are no way realistic. When you see Michael Schumacher down here in the bottom of the mid pack, where in real life he won this race by an embarrassing margin. In real life there's only 3 cars on the lead lap, I think, by the end. Oh, Schumacher lost 2 places there. He got screwed. I think he's in trouble or something. Also, doing this here at F1 allows you to do that. Say, oh, I overtook Michael Schumacher. Yay. Look at me go. We're rapidly catching up to this pack ahead. As we continue this recovery drive, I want to get back on that podium. We got the pace. We just need to keep it on track, take our opportunities, and it's doable. How long we've gone into this race. Doesn't feel like long, but I'm sure we've done a few laps. I'll have to check that when I get a chance. Again, the problem with running F1 cars, especially at a street circuit like Melbourne, is you've no time to check anything. We're in 15th place, that's nice. Fuel time says we're approximately 15 laps in. And that's pretty accurate, we are 16 laps in. That gives a hint of our strategy. We are pitting on lap 30. Scheduled anyway. I think the fuel will last a little longer. But I feel it's a good time to split up the race, so we'll do that. The reason we're pitting halfway through the race and not doing anything clever, such as trying to do a two-stop or anything like that, is because the AI is not capable of doing anything like that. The AI in automobiles, they pit on fuel, not tires, because AI don't have tire wear. They're not affected by tire wear. So they can only pit by fuel. And when they pit by fuel, they run their tanks empty and always take on full tanks in their stops. So we're going to sort of have to mimic that by, when we pit, we take full fuel, which effectively means it only makes sense to run the tanks dry. Which conveniently, with these cars, seem to be about half a Grand Prix distance, give or take a few laps. Here we're pitting lap 30, 58 lap race, full tanks go 30 laps, plenty, easy. It doesn't give us much room to overtake on strategy. Though positions may shift around in the pit stops, depending on how well some people do, some people get messed up. I still think that can happen to AI. As we see this car demonstrating they can make mistakes, but things can happen in the pit stops, especially if there's a lot of people pitting at once, which there probably will be, considering everyone is practically on the same strategy. Gotta avoid that ourselves, though. It's all good saying we might make positions from others' mistakes, but no, that doesn't work if you make the mistake yourself. Oh, we definitely have to pace on these guys. Slight tap there. Freaked him out a little bit. He's like, nope, I'm out of this. You go. Which means he was the exact opposite of his teammate, and that he was actually a gentleman. Even if I wasn't exactly that gentlemanly, slightly prodding him out of the way. Like, just push him over to the side a little. Like, nope, no, you're done here. Go back. I'm coming through. A little bit of a cut there. You have to watch that. Because if your floor hits the top of that curb, you're going flying. It's a possibility with that curb, but it's high enough. Don't want the plank to touch that. Otherwise, you get in trouble. Also, what makes these cars actually quite easy to drive is the track control. Don't know why I just saw it there. I was reminded from the noise that. You're probably wondering what the hell is that whenever I put the power down, like the rattling noise. As if it's the rev limiter, but it's not the rev limiter. But it kind of is the rev limiter. That's just the traction control, which this car's had, legally. They also had automatic upshifts, which I'm not running, which is for full manual, but it was a thing in real life that these cars had. Traction control didn't get banned until maybe a season or two later. I believe upshifts were quickly banned, though it didn't last long, the automatic gearboxes. Screw up in front of us is steadily strung out a bit as this race goes on, which makes our job a little bit trickier. Because we could do these cars being together in a pack and racing each other so that they hold each other up. Yeah, they're still fairly close, but they're just lapping together like this. They're not having a bearing on each other's lap time.
On your left. Hold your line. Clear. Car right.
Robin's racing.
Keep left. All clear.
That was quite aggressive. He turned into me, I swear. That was full luck. Also showing why there might have been as much overtaking in this era. Because that's so difficult to get a clean overtake. Actually, you have to be good. Which I know is a crazy thought that, you know, there has to be driver skilled involved in overtakes. That's heresy. But that's what it was like back then, and hence there was less overtaking. So the obvious fix for that was to make it easier to overtake by giving people DRS, and that was that. To be fair, if we had DRS, say we're in this situation with some of the modern cars, I would have been in front of this group by now. But we gotta actually work first. Slightly more careful if I actually had damage enabled at the moment. As from people when I race, I don't have damage turned on at the start of races, because that's when the AI are prone to do, you know, stupid things, as we saw with the way I got punted off. So I don't want to have my race ruined because of some AI stupidity. So I leave damage off. That being said, I have a sort of rule to make sure I don't be a complete idiot, and that once we pit, it'll be turned back on for the second stint, which makes sense as the field should be spread out by then. Or if I hit something. So say I go off and hit a wall, then we turn on damage immediately afterwards, so that I don't get a second chance. Well, I do get a second chance. But you know, it's sort of a... It allows myself to have a second chance, is what I'm trying to say. But it doesn't let me abuse it. Yeah, it's Massa in front of us. And Sauber used to look like that. I had a run in there, but it's very hard to overtake into that corner, so it's not worth going for a move there. Oh, we're definitely faster than all over the back of him.
On your right, clear right.
One draft, give me a run. By Patrick. Hit the wrong button, as you see. Try to engage DRS in a car with no DRS. I wonder if the science of drag reduction systems had even been really discovered at this point. It wouldn't even be sort of a theoretical thing for another few years, actually. You know, the idea of changing wing angles to reduce drag. Usually, there's the next Sauber. On the other side is McLaren. Cool charge. He's a bit low down in the field. He's getting held up by the Sauber as well, though. Which is good for us. So hopefully we can pass them a bit cleaner than the last few. I don't want to pass dirty, but these guys are not really giving much choice. I know that's a typical excuse. Oh, it's the other guy's fault. And really, that's not how things work at all. Yeah, it's the overtaking car's responsibility to ensure that the pass is clean. But this is F1, and everything is everyone else's fault. I need to roleplay a bit, okay? Get in the mindset. Slight tap, but lifted. I didn't want to take advantage of that twice. That's left Mass. No, not Massa. Massa's teammate, whoever Massa's teammate is. Get away with it. A lot of dust getting thrown up. It made me think that there's some parts of this track where the game thinks there's dust, and there isn't. Also, that curve needs to be slightly longer. So, I'm convinced that the curves were laid up here by people who want to watch the world burn. Which seems to be the main mentality of modern curve laying on tracks. They want to see you suffer. You know, from the speed bumps and runoffs to curves that are set up so that they cause fatigue failures. You know, they're just designed to kill you. Safety, am I right?
Car right. All clear.
Also, the default AMS spotter is next to useless when calling cars next to you. Basically, all it's useful is for calling when a car is clear, because by the time he calls a car clear, you're about 20 meters ahead or behind him. So, when he says they're clear, he's pretty accurate. When he says they're next to you, take that with a pinch of salt. Probably a way to tune that a little bit. I should probably look into that, because his calls for car right, car left are next to useless. Speaking of next to useless, I've been next to useless in making progress here.
Right side. Clear. Car left. All clear.
Hell of a dive. But still managed to make it. More or less by just parking the fucking thing on the apex. And be like, nope, you can't get the cup back because there's a whole car in your way. Perpendicular to the racing line.
Yellow flag.
Uh-huh. Shenanigans. That's rare. Oh, we've two cars off on the gravel. One of them's my teammate. Fisichella, please. That's interesting to see. I haven't really seen that before. Ever. Where AI going for an overtake will mess it up. No wonder he's requested a pit stop. He's buried in a wall. Highfield made a mistake. Everyone's losing the run themselves. Cars run each other off track. People in the gravel, we've Coulthard going for a move. This is getting intense. Gotta keep the wits about us and not join them in the wall. Yeah, but as I was saying there before this battle got going again, was I've never seen that from the AI cars. I've seen them make mistakes. It's one of the notable things of automobiles, the AI, is the fact that they do occasionally make mistakes, like real drivers. I've never seen them actually collide like that in what looks like somewhat realistic. I've seen them collide like idiots when they're, you know, being idiot AI, but that looks like a realistic crash. You know, from what we saw, it looked like two drivers just going for an overtake and someone didn't pull out. And there was trouble. Looks like, though, from that, he got back. No, his legs in the pit, so wasn't that damaged. Also, we don't know what happened to the other car, as I'm not their teammate. Looks like they got lucky. They might have actually hit the wall and might have just run off into the gravel, but stopped it before the wall. So that's good for Jordan. And as we keep going. I still haven't got a proper line through the last corner. It feels like it should be nearly flat out, the last corner. But you put the power down and then you feel you got almost immediately lift again. End up a lot of time just sort of having to do a half lift. Which is then awkward because the speed of that corner speed is just the top of the rev limit for first gear, but then it feels a bit low for second gear. It's just an awkward corner. Since making that mistake, Hyde feels more or less kept it together, which is not letting us really get much on him. I don't know if we're making or losing ground to the pack ahead, but I can see them. That's positive. Everything's going good, right? Except for the fact that we should be fighting for a podium at the moment. But everything's going good. I wonder if this is also Highfield's debut. I would think so, considering that he's still racing and most of this field has retired. Well, not most of them, but you know, looking at the current field, a lot of them have or are near the end of their career or sort of haven't. Even the ones that are still racing are sort of taking it back, except for those who went to IndyCar. Because IndyCar drivers last forever, it seems. Now get back.
On your right. Clear right. Right side. Clear right.
Now that punishing me for that small mistake. Why can't I do that? I make a small mistake, get instantly overtaken. Cars in front of me make about 20 mistakes, and I still haven't overtaken them.
Keep right. Clear
left. Where's the driver? I should probably get good. Then I'd be able to do what Coulthard did there. Of course, this fighting has let Highfield get away. As you see, just how quickly a small mistake and a little bit of battling, and boom, you're 2 seconds back. Oh. What's the fuel level like? 16. It means it's lap 30. That sort of flew. I was not expecting a pit stop now. They're ready for the pit stop. I think we're gonna do it. I think we'll stick to the plan. We still have enough fuel for, let's call them, 3 more laps, and that seems about right. But we will actually pit this time. Wonder if we'll be joined by anyone else, I doubt. I think we'll be one of the first of it. Okay. Full tank fuel, new tires. So this is a few people in. Wonder if that's kind of truly nice. Right, that's us done to the end. Where have we come out? Ooh! Not only as me completely messing up the pit exit, but someone's left their wings behind them. Come out 17th. I forget where he pisses.
Caution.
I'll get back to that in a moment. When I stop being an absolute idiot. Right, so obviously the tires are not up to temperature or some shit like that. And that more or less throws away whatever positions we could have made on the pit side. Fuck's sake, Montoya. I'd like to think I wouldn't have made a mistake there if he didn't. You know, that sort of group thing, synergy shit, that if someone else makes a mistake, you make a mistake after them. Isn't that what we need, though? We need to get past him and into clear air, put down some solid laps, especially after making our mistake. Everyone else is making stops, and we need to make advantage of this. I wonder how long we're behind the leader. Well, the fact that Trulli is not the leader anymore means that he's pitted. Bernoldi, yeah, he was the Arrows driver that punted us off, so he was probably running second. So he has not pitted yet. Which is interesting, split strategy on the front, they're not covering each other, they're doing their own thing. So there's some excitement. Probably what the TV cameras are looking at. Probably ignoring the Jordan that, you know, made a fuck up on his pit exit and is losing positions because of that. Needed the pitters. Yep, they're all pitting up front. We're too far back to get that much of a jump. How's Bernoldi leader again? Things are happening up front, and we have very little information to figure out what's happening up front. All we know, things are happening. The lead has changed a little bit, probably on pit cycle. Yeah. Things are happening down below, as you can see. I think we gained position on someone pitted. There's another wing out in the gravel. Oh yeah, I forgot my own rule. Time turn damage on. So, no more bumping and barging, because I want to keep my wings. Downforce is kind of important, you know? half of me after the pit stop, but I'm putting my wheels in the gravel more than I should be. That was fine, so I pitted. I'm going to blame these tires. That's a very F1 thing to do. Oh, I didn't like this particular set of tires. They didn't agree with me. Sounds about right. Whoever wishes in our group come before he pitches. I think he might have been. If so, we're gaining on them. Unfortunately, it means, thanks to our mistakes when we were exiting the pits, we have lost positions. That's not good. Yep, there's that group ahead that we were with before the pit stops. Looks like they all, either they're still going, which I doubt it, or they pitted together. Ooh, that's wide, hold it together. That is very weird. The only thing I can think of is, did I start on soft tires and now switch to mediums, which would be the plan? Well, the plan would have been start on mediums as well. That could explain some things. Unfortunately, as you can tell, there's no way an automobilista for... No!
The caution flag is out.
There goes my rear wing. And possibly my front wing as well.
Watch out, yellow flag.
That goes nearly everything. Now the car refusing to drive. Yes. Oh, we're stuck. I think we're stuck. No, we're not. It's live. It's not. It's live. It's not. It's live. I don't know. Come on. Pull, you bastard. It's stuck. It's dead. Come on. Get out of this thing. How far behind are we now? There's the leader. We pulled ourselves straight in front of the leader and
into the yellow flag.
Oh no.
Car left. All clear.
What the hell? Well, that's interesting.
Blue flag.
What's going on now? Guys, I know I'm not saying much, but I'm trying to figure out as much as you guys. What's the situation here? Right, so we've inadvertently taken out second place. As you can see, there's no safety car. Safety cars don't really work that well in offline races, or in any road racing in Automobilista. Yeah, so we're kind of stuck here. As there's no safety car, there's no real gaps for us to do anything. No, he's just pinged off and retired. And I may have to do that myself. Car's still kind of running. We're a lap down from everyone. And I think, yeah, I think that's going to be it. Car's dead. We're out of position. Fuck it. Yeah. Disappointing end to the Australian Grand Prix. We got 36 laps done. No, 35 I think actually. Yeah, we got 35. Nearly 36 if we made the line. But if you remember earlier, I said, don't cut that curb. Because if you ground out on that curb, you're going to get flung off into nowhere. And guess what happened? I got flung off. And then we hit a wall. And that was that. We lost our wings. And then for some reason, it looks like Barrichello just hit us. Which is a pretty dumb move. So that's going to be a cause of controversy this week in F1. I was glad to provide it. Right, next week. Not next week. On the 31st is the Brazilian Grand Prix. Where I'll be in a different car. And hopefully we will do a bit better than this. We might even actually finish. That's my goal more or less for this season. Is if I can finish more races than I start, that's positive. If I can avoid finishing last in the majority of races, that's my other goal. But sorry for having such a disappointing end to this, but there's no way of putting it. That's motor racing, and that sucks. So yeah, I'll see you on the 31st when we attempt the Brazilian Grand Prix. So that's that.